Thank you, Jesus. Would you raise your voice this morning? Thank you, Lord.
Oh, magnify the Lord with me. Let us exalt his name together. Did anybody come to lift up the name of Jesus this morning? He's worthy of a praise. We magnify your name, Jesus. Oh, magnify the Lord, for he is worthy to be praised. Oh, magnify the Lord, for he is worthy to be praised. If you know a thing, oh,
magnify the Lord,
for he is worthy.
For he is worthy to be praised.
Oh, magnify the Lord.
Oh, magnify the Lord. My strong tower.
My strong tower.
My strong tower.
Yes, he is.
Yes, he is.
Messiah, He's my Savior. Lord, there is power in Your name. Yeah. You're my rock and my Redeemer.
there salvation in any other, for there is no other name under heaven given among men whereby we must be saved. At the name of Jesus, every knee shall bow, every tongue will confess that he is Lord of all. Hallelujah. Aren't you glad you know the name of Jesus? Aren't you glad you called on the name of Jesus? Hallelujah. I'm telling you, the name of Jesus can solve any problem. Hallelujah. Amen. I feel the presence of the Lord in this place right now. I'm so very thankful for each and every one of you that are here today. Amen. If you would, turn to someone near you, smile at them, shake their hand, say, I'm so glad to see you. And you can be seated for just a moment, please. Amen. We are so delighted each of you are here. We're going to worship the Lord in the giving of our tithe and offering. If you are trying or you want to give by way of cash or check here in the main auditorium, ushers are coming through with envelopes at this time. If you need an envelope, just lift your hand. We'll be sure to get one to you. There are several ways to give, and you should see them on the screen behind me. There they are. Amen. And while you're preparing your offering, we have some video announcements, and please pay attention to the screen.
Welcome to the Pentecostal Katy. We're glad you joined us this Sunday. Please pay close attention to the screen as we discuss some upcoming events happening here at the POK.
On September 29th through October 1st, we'll be hosting our annual Zion Music Conference. On Monday the 26th, we'll have a Zion Bag Assembly Night, where we will put together all the goodie bags for our people attending the conference. In place of midweek service on Wednesday, September 28th, we have a church-wide work night to prepare for this big weekend. If you have free time, we would really appreciate all hands on deck, cleaning the church for the incoming conference attendees. Our previous Wednesday night service has now been moved to Thursday the 29th. The evening services for this event are open to the public, with preaching by Pastor Court Chavis. We would love to see you there.
On October 8th, our men's ministry will be having a barbecue cook-off competition from 4 p.m. until 7 p.m. Seven teams will compete for the title POK Grill Champion Team of the Universe. For just a small admission fee of $5, we'd love you to join in for some great barbecue, activities, and fellowship with the great men of our church. You can purchase your ticket in the foyer following our AM service.
On Sunday, October 16th, we will be celebrating All Nations Sunday. We will have guest speaker Scott Graham, as well as a children's evangelist, to come and speak to all of our kids. After the morning service, there will be tables set up highlighting different nations represented by our church body. If you would like to display a table, there's a sign-up sheet in the foyer.
If you're a guest, we invite you to visit with us in the foyer at our Connect booth. Thank you for your attention during these announcements. And once again, we are so excited to have you join us this Sunday here at the POK.
Amen. That was terrific. Just a couple of disclaimers. The first one is there is no work night this Wednesday night. So that was a misstatement. But we are having church Thursday night. We want our regular midweek service. Everyone, come to the Thursday night service. You're going to be blessed. Zion's one of the highlights of the year here at the Pentecostals. You don't want to miss it. If you've never been before, you are going to be blessed. It is a fantastic conference, and it's going to be outstanding. Also, Brother Chase, if you would help me right here. Here it is, gentlemen. This is, hold it up high. There you go. This is the Barbecue Championship, Intergalactic Barbecue Champion Trophy right here. So this is what you're working for. This is what you're going for. Amen. And that's going to be exciting, and that's coming up October the 8th. Amen. Why don't we all stand together? Thank you, Brother Chase. Amen. Let's stand together. If you have your offering, lift that to the Lord, and let's go to him in prayer. Lord, we're so very thankful for this chance to be with your people and to give to your kingdom. We ask you to bless both the gift and the giver in Jesus' name. And everyone has said amen. God bless you as you give.
All my shackles and set me free, robed me and gave me the victory. I've got a reason to praise. I can't ignore what my eyes have seen. What seemed impossible, I believe. Look at my life, we've got his story. I've got a reason to praise. And I won't let a wrong cry out
shackles, stole my shackles and set me free.
Broke me
and gave me the victory. I got a reason to praise.
I can't ignore
what my eyes have seen.
What seemed impossible,
I believe. Look at my life, we got history. I got a reason to praise.
Quiet! Could we just take one moment and cry out to the Lord? Hallelujah. For he is worthy of praise, honor, and glory. Hallelujah. I don't want to get boisterous and noisy for my favorite team and not get noisy and boisterous for my God. I don't want to shout for my favorite baseball team and my baseball player and not shout for the Lord and Savior of my soul. Hallelujah. For 1 second, would you just raise your voice right now and let him know that he's worthy of praise. He's worthy of honor. He's worthy of glory, God. Oh, Lord, hallelujah. I don't want a rock to replace me when it's shouting for you. Glory and honor to the King of Kings. Hallelujah. Oh, thank you. Hallelujah, Lord. You're so wonderful. Thank you, church. You may return to your seat. We want to welcome everybody to the house of the Lord. What a beautiful day it is today, and we're glad that you're with us. If this is your first or second time with us and you did not fill out a card or you did not sign up with one of the hostesses or sign in, please raise your hand. We want to make sure that we acknowledge you. We have some gifts that you can redeem after service, but we have to have you fill out a card. If you did not fill out a card or you did not sign in with the hostesses or usher team, please raise your hand. We'll get you taken care of. We want to make sure that we acknowledge you. We have several people here with us today, but we also want to acknowledge all those that are tuning in online. Why don't we give a big round of applause to all our brothers and sisters that are tuning in online via Revival Radio, Facebook, YouTube, whatever it is. Now, when I mention your name, if you wouldn't mind letting us know where you're seated just by raising your hand, we just know where you're at, because in a few minutes, we're going to get up and walk around and greet each other, and we want to make sure that we greet all our guests. We have several guests with us this morning, and we have for the first time Signa Gonzalez. Where are you seated, Signa? Back here. We're so happy that you're with us. Sorry I didn't see you. Welcome to the Pentecostals. We also have Michael and Esther Jones. Where are you seated this morning? Right here. We're so happy that you guys are with us. Welcome, welcome. We also want to welcome for this first time the Alegria family. The Alegria family, welcome to the Pentecostals. We're so glad to have you. We also have with us for the first time Paolo. Paolo, right here. We're so glad that you're here, sir. Welcome. We also have a second-time guest, or a VIP guest. We like to call them VIPs because they came back for a second time to be with us. We have Sherri-Ann Finley. Where are you seated? Right here. We're so glad that you're with us. Welcome. And we also have with us Sonia Barrios. Sonia, where are you seated this morning? Special guest with us. Is this a friend of Sister Cherie? We're so glad that you're here. We'll treat you good even though you're a friend of Cherie's. Now, what we're going to do is we're going to put 5 minutes on the screen, and this is going to give you enough time to get up and greet everybody. This is also the time where we're going to dismiss our youth and preteens to their classrooms. So, church, why don't you stand to your feet with me? We're going to put 5 minutes on the screen. Shake as many hands as possible. Let all our guests know that you're happy to see them. Once that time runs out, if you wouldn't mind making your way back to your seat, and we will move on with the service. Thank you.
trust the power of your word. Enough to seek your kingdom first, beyond the barren dress, beyond the ocean waves. When I go through the waters, I won't be overcome. When I go through the rivers, I will not be drowned. My God will make a way, so I am not afraid.
You keep the promises you made.
I'm so thankful that God will keep his hand on us and protect us. Amen. Good morning, everyone. You may be seated. I'm thankful that I don't have to be afraid. I don't have to worry. God will always be with us. And I want to say to all of our guests that are with us this morning, if I haven't met you yet, my name is Rob McKee, and I'm the senior pastor here at the Pentecostals. That beautiful lady that was leading us in singing is my wife, Shara, and we're just thrilled that you're here with us this morning. You know, we often talk about being an apostolic church, and I believe apostolic churches are churches that are not perfect. They have problems. It's evidenced, of course, with all the epistles and the challenges that were corrected by the apostles. For those of you that studying your Bible is new, The New Testament begins with four books of the Bible that we refer to as the Gospels: Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John. They are the story, the chronological story of the birth, the life, the ministry, the death, the burial, and the resurrection of Jesus Christ. But they funnel, chronologically funnel, into one book of the Bible that we refer to as the Book of Acts, or literally the Acts of the Apostles. The purpose for Christ's coming was to establish the church. It wasn't just to give us an example. He was coming to give birth to a church, and that happened on the day of Pentecost. So that's why we call ourselves Pentecostals, is because we want to tie ourselves to that original experience that happened on the day of Pentecost. There's no deep theology to the name, other than we just want to practice the same thing that they practiced. We want to preach the same doctrine that they preached. We want to baptize the same way that they baptized. We want to see a move of the Holy Ghost just like they experienced a move of the Holy Ghost. We want to see miracles like they experienced miracles. And so if you're new to the Pentecostals, we are a Pentecostal church, and we're unashamed of that. And, we want to be just like that Book of Acts church from the first century. But what we often do not talk about is how that there was more happening in the Book of Acts than just revival, but they experienced problems. We first find the first problem they experienced. It was in Acts chapter 4, particularly when there was such growth and revival in the church. You remember the first day there was 3,000 souls, and then just a few days later, after the healing of the lame man in chapter 3, there was a revival that consisted of 5,000 people added to the church. So literally, in the space of maybe 2 weeks, we don't know for sure, but about 2 weeks, the church went from 120, or if you count the people that were at the ascension, maybe 500 or so, it went from that number to 8,000. That's fascinating to me. 8,000 people, and you've got to, many of them have got to have housing and clothing and food. They're from out of town. They've moved to Jerusalem, just to be part of the church. And so the first issue that arose in the New Testament church was that people didn't have a place to live. There was no space for them. They needed, they needed facilities. So the first problem that existed in the church was problems with the facility. And so everybody started to sacrifice for this and give towards this. And that's when Ananias and Sapphira got in trouble. You remember the story? They sold some land and brought it to the church and said, "This is all that we got for it," just trying to make a name for themselves. And of course, God judged them for it. But it started off with a problem of facilities. That's what the first issue was. The second issue of the church occurred in Acts chapter 7. This was the second problem that occurred within the church body. And that was an issue when some of the Greek widows felt neglected. And it was a relational problem. It was the church had gotten so big that people felt like, well, man, we're not, everybody else is getting ministry, but we're not getting ministry. And so the second issue in the church was people issues. Problems within the body. People didn't feel like they were getting ministry because of growth. Both problems were good problems to have. One was the facilities. Other was the need for more people to get involved in ministry. And that's when all of the good men were called from the congregation, men that were leaders, and among them was Stephen. And Stephen was the first martyr of the New Testament church. He was the first person that was executed for his belief, and he was executed by stoning. And I was thinking this morning these two problems that existed. That's kind of where we are right now. We're growing as a church. I was just over in our Spanish service, and it's a completely packed sanctuary. Of course, we had a large crowd in here. That's why we dismiss all the different classes, just to make room for us to have seating in here, because when we all come together, it's going to be crowded. And so we'll have to put out a lot of extra chairs. So the only way we can facilitate the crowd is to break off different groups and have them meet in different sanctuaries right now. But that's a Book of Acts problem. That's a That's a good problem to have. And we are resolving that issue by our capital campaign and all that's happening with the new construction. I want to tell you a little bit about that in a minute. But, of course, the second issue is relational issues or ministry, people issues. And that was a Book of Acts problem. It's a problem today. You may feel like, well, man, I'm forgotten. I'm just one of a lot of people in a crowd. But if you ever feel that way, the answer is not to become offended. Don't be offended. These are good problems for churches to have. They're Book of Acts problems to have. What God needs are individuals to come out of the crowd and to get involved in the work. And that's what happened in the Book of Acts when Stephen was called out of the congregation. You know, this is not the sermon this morning, but I just feel to share it. It's fascinating to me that on hell's hit list, they had to try to stop the church. They wanted to stop this Christianity movement. And so of all of the people that hell had a problem with, it wasn't a preacher. Their number one on hell's hit list was not what we would call a minister. But they were ministering. They were out there. They were just doing the work of ministry, ministering to people one-on-one. Stephen was a man filled with the Holy Ghost. He was used in the gifts of the Spirit, but he was a saint in the church. He was a powerful witness and won many people to the Lord, but he was not a preacher, not a pulpiteer. Amen. And so it's fascinating how that just our thinking gets changed at times. We can think, well, because I'm not a preacher, I don't matter. Oh, that's not true. The first century church, the number one threat to hell was not a preacher. It was a saint. They said, we're going to take him out first. And so I want to encourage you, as you see the church growing, find a place to serve. God wants to use you. Find a place that you can work in ministry. All right, concerning the growth, real quick, I know that we've already mentioned this, but as you leave this morning, please be careful walking around outside. There's several places we're preparing to pour concrete, I believe, tomorrow or Tuesday. And so right now there's a lot of holes out there. We don't want anybody to break their neck. Now, that's one part of the first century church that we don't want to duplicate. Poor Eutychus, he fell asleep out of an upstairs window. We don't want to have to do that. So please don't anybody break your neck, okay? So just please be careful as you leave today. There's several places. There's no curb. So Lord willing, we'll get all of that taken care of this week. And we have already framed up the kitchen for the family center. They've started on the second story over the top of the kitchen over next door. If you want to peek in there, the best way to do it is to go all the way down the hallway and just keep walking until you can't walk anymore. And there's some plastic up, but the plastic is loose. You can step in there and just take a quick look around. Just please be careful if you do. And we don't want anybody to get hurt in all the construction stuff, especially if you see kids, pull them in. It's not exactly a safe place. So, but a lot of things are happening. I did want to give a quick update. Lord willing, okay, we're going to just create a window. Everything with the family center, Lord willing, should be finished and completed by the second to the last week of November. Okay? And so we've got some folks that are already talking about, I think that we're already planning on a big Christmas banquet, church-wide Christmas banquet. We'll be able to fit everybody in there, and it's going to be a whole lot of fun. But all of that will be finished, and then the first weekend in December, we are having a groundbreaking for our new sanctuary. So all of that's moving forward. I'm excited about what God is going to do. And I want to thank you for your faithfulness and your giving and your sacrificial giving towards the capital campaign we're going to have. If you are new and you haven't gotten involved in it yet, you're going to get your chance. We've got a service coming up the weekend after All Nations, 2 weeks from now, October the 23rd. And we'll be reintroducing it, sort of relaunching it. And so you can jump in at that point. If you need information before then, you can see Dr. Wilson and or one of the men on the platform. They can get you a packet. And the packet explains everything. So if you just want to pick that up, you can do that. All right. I've talked long enough this morning. I do want to greet just a few more guests. It's great to have, is it Mauro Ivo? Mauro Ivo? God bless you. Good to have you here today, sir. Also, Kylie Reyes. Kylie Reyes. Okay. Oh, she's over in the youth. Amen. Well, it's great to have all of you. Why don't we stand together? This, typically, if you are unfamiliar with POK, you're new. I normally preach most Sunday mornings, but last Sunday, I just felt impressed to preach on a Sunday night. So we had another speaker on Sunday morning, and the same is true today. I'm going to be preaching in the service this evening, and so I've asked Dr. Wilson to preach this morning service, and he's going to be delivering the word of the Lord. And I know that you're going to be blessed. We had a great first service, early service. And amen. I believe that God is going to be with us here today. I do want to encourage you, if you want to hear me preach, come on back tonight. Now, even if you don't want to hear me preach, still come back tonight, please. And there's a lot of great things that are going to be happening in the service. Also, this week, remember, I know they've already mentioned, but this week, no service Wednesday night. It's moved to Thursday night. And I'm asking for your help, okay? It's a big conference. There'll be a lot of people here. A lot of exciting things are happening. Great music. Folks from all across the U.S. will be here and Canada. And but I'll be preaching the Thursday night service. And so please come and support me. Support your local friendly neighborhood pastor. And I will appreciate that. Amen. God bless you. Dr. Wilson, would you come?
If you love the Lord, give the Lord a hand clap of praise. Hallelujah. God, you're worthy. We love you, Jesus. Praise God. Amen, amen. Turn with me in your Bibles to the book of Psalms, chapter 13. Psalms 13. I was going to minister along these lines 2 weeks ago on a Sunday p.m., but the service... God had a different design for it, and I am going to pick back up with what the Lord had dealt with me about, getting ready for that weekend, and speak from Psalms 13. How long wilt thou forget me, O Lord, forever? How long wilt thou hide thy face from me? How long shall I take counsel in my soul, having sorrow in my heart daily? How long shall mine enemy be exalted over me? Consider and hear me, O Lord my God. Lighten mine eyes, lest I sleep the sleep of death. Lest mine enemies say, I have prevailed against him. And those that trouble me rejoice when I am moved. Notice these first four verses of Scripture. David is, sounds like he's in a lot of dismay. He's moaning, groaning. He's somewhat complaining. He's in trouble. And as you read it, you can just feel the weight that in your imagination of what David was dealing with at the time. But in verse 5, it begins to change. He says, but I have trusted in thy mercy. And then he says, my heart shall rejoice in thy salvation. Amen. How many know that when you are going through trouble, you can turn your thinking around and you can rejoice in the Lord of your salvation? Amen. And then he says in verse 6, I will sing unto the Lord because he hath dealt bountifully with me. Amen. Help the Lord. I want to speak from these first three words here in verse 6. I will sing. Would you turn around and look at your neighbor and say, I will sing. If you'd like to, just turn around to somebody near you and sing that. Sing, I will sing. Amen. God bless you. You may be seated. Some of you are thinking it is way too early in the morning to do that. And by the sound of your voice, I would agree. No, I'm just kidding. I'm just kidding. I didn't hear you sing. Man, my mind, I'm telling you immediately, I don't want to pick on Brother Oyer, but I better not. I'll save that for later. Here a while back came across a story that just fascinated me. It's a story how a very small fragment of an unwanted audio recording actually became to be a very celebrated musical work in recent times. This, I say recent times in comparison to the history of humanity. We're looking back in about the 70s when this became a very powerful piece. It has impacted hundreds of thousands of people. It was in 1971 when an English composer by the name of Galvin Byers, at the time he was growing in his skill set. He was living in London, and he began working with a friend by the name of Alan Power. Now, Alan Power was a guy who was putting together a film, and he was filming at the time homeless people that were living on the streets of what was known as the Elephant and Castle and also Waterloo Station. This would have been the area that Charlie Chaplin grew up in London, and he was filming these homeless people that many of them were alcoholics. And in the course of this film, they would, it was interesting, they captured these homeless people, alcoholics, that they were singing songs. They were drunk, but they were singing. And they were singing bits of opera. They were singing pieces of ballads. And they found one particular elderly man, and he was actually recorded, in which he was singing, but he was not singing opera or a ballad. He was singing a gospel song. And interesting, this one particular elderly man was the only one that they captured on film that did not drink. He would not partake of alcohol. This film was not ultimately used in this documentary that they put forth, and but there were sections of this tape that were unused, and one of them was 20 seconds long, and it was this elderly man singing, and they were given to Briars. And so Briars is going through this, and he's listening to it, and because it's not being used in the film, he was to do the mixer and some of the editing of the film, but these fragmented pieces were given to him, so he was just listening to them, and when he heard this elderly man singing this gospel song, it got his attention. And the reason was is because Briar had been raised in church when he was a little child, and so when he heard the words of this elderly man singing, he recognized where the song was coming from, that the man was singing. It was fragmented pieces. It wasn't the total song. It's a little bit messed up in some of the words, but he knew where the elderly man had gotten it from. And so he was drawn to the voice. He was drawn to the story that here's this elderly man living on the streets of London, and he's singing this gospel song. So he went back home, and he began to play this little clip, and he found that the tune matched what he could play on his piano, and he began to play along with this man singing, and he noticed that the first section of the song, which was 13 bars in length, it formed a very effective loop that repeated, but in a slightly unpredictable manner, and so he actually took that loop. And in his words, he said, "I copied the loop into a continuous reel of tape, thinking perhaps of adding an orchestrated accompaniment to this." So interesting. He's very creative. He's thinking, I could take this homeless man who is singing. I've got this little recording of him, 20 seconds long, and I could take a 13-second segment or 13 bars in length, and I could put some music to it. And so he said that I actually copied it, because I knew it was fragile. I wanted to make sure I had it. And he said, I left the door of the recording room open, and he went to go get a cup of coffee. And he said, but next to the door where he had the little studio was a painting studio. And he said, when I came back, his words, when I came back, I found the normally lively room unnaturally subdued. People were moving about much more slowly than usual, and a few were sitting alone, quietly weeping. I was puzzled until I realized that the tape was still playing and that they had been overcome by the old man's singing. Now, he actually went and put the music to this man singing and released it, and there were literally hundreds of thousands of people that were impacted deeply by it. And we actually have a little bit of recording. I want you to hear this man singing here just for a second. This is back in 1971 when his voice was recorded.
With me, yet never found with me, yet Jesus' blood never found with me, yet this one thing I know, for he loves me so. Jesus' blood never found me, yet never found me, yet Jesus' blood never found me, yet this one thing I know, for he loves me so. Jesus.
You can go on, if you go YouTube, look it up and listen to it. The music builds. It's an amazing piece. When I stumbled across this a few weeks back, I was sitting in the living room of my house, and I was playing it, and my eyes swelled up with tears, and Carrie, she was across the room and listening to it. It was just a very quiet moment there in our living room, and she began to sing the song. It's a little different. It comes from a song we used to sing when I was a kid, that Jesus love. Not blood, but his love, his actual words, never failed me yet. It's never failed me yet. This one thing I know. And then my mind has gone blank with the next line. Before he loves me so, Jesus' love has never failed me yet. And it's just amazing when you think about that this is a homeless man who was singing this song. Now, I'm just going to go out on the limb real quick and just make some really strong statements. There are some of us that we're not as destitute as that man was, but we struggle to sing our song. Amen. There are some of us that got it fairly well, and we struggle in singing our song because of the stuff that we go through. I want you to know here this morning, I want to declare it right from the very beginning, I don't care what you're going through, when you know whose side you're on and who's on your side, you can sing. Amen. Look at your neighbor and say, you can sing. David is the one who's written Psalms 13. And he begins his psalm by saying, how long, O Lord, will you forget me forever? How long are you going to hide your face from me? How long must I take counsel in my soul and have sorrow in my heart all day? How long will my enemy be exalted above me? And so David four times is asking the question, how long? Anybody ever been there this morning that you've just wondered, God, how long must I go through this? How long before this changes? Come on now. Oh, yeah, there's some honesty in here today. How long? Yeah, Lord, how long? How long am I going to go through this? Now, we don't know the exact time period that David is referring to when he's writing this or writing about. Most commentators seem to believe that this was during the time that Saul was trying to kill David. But we're not certain of that. Some feel it maybe during the time of David's son Absalom when he rose up against him. So there's a lot of different opinions, but majority believe that this was during the time that Saul was trying to kill David, and certainly it is fitting during that time because David, when he was anointed to be king by the prophet Samuel, David, he did not immediately head to the throne. Instead, the Bible lets us know that David went right back to taking care of the sheep. David was a what we would call today a servant leader. He was a servant first, leader second, and he pursued the service. And so it wasn't long that he was called into service in the king's palace. Now, you would think if you were going to write the story, write the script, you would think that the best place to learn how to be a king, if you're going to be a king, would be to make sure that you're in the king's palace. It would get you connected with the different various people who would oversee different things and the inner workings of everything that went on in the palace. But instead, that's not the life that David lived. David ended up having to flee for his life as Saul sought to kill him. And David lived for many years from one cave to another. He lived on the run. And this was not a short span of time. This wasn't something that David experienced for a few months, but this was something that David experienced for years. You and I, we go through times of difficulty. And there are times that of difficulty that it just knocks the wind out of us. It just causes us to lay awake at night trying to figure it out in our mind. We're trying to analyze it and try to put everything in its proper place, trying to make sense out of it. But there are some times, could someone say, man, that I have gone through some things in life when I laid my head down at night that I couldn't solve it at night. I couldn't figure it out. I got up in the morning, it was still there. My mind was still trying to deal with the situation. And then throughout the day, I didn't feel like eating a whole lot because my mind was still trying to figure out. I lost my appetite a little bit. I didn't go on just for a few hours, but I've experienced weeks of that. I've had times in my life where it seemed as though that it was months. There were times, a little reprieves here and there, but a whole lot of, God, how long must I continue to deal with this issue? How long must we go through this? How long before things change? God, how long? Anybody ever been there this morning? How long? And you notice when you look at what David is saying here, he goes, how long will you hide your face from me? In other words, there are times in our life in which it seems as though that we have lost the blessing of the Lord. It's like, God, how long will you hide your face from me? It's like, God, how long must I go through this and not be blessed? How long before this turns around? He says, how long shall I take counsel in my soul and having sorrow in my heart daily? In other words, David is saying that there are things that consume me so much that I have trouble sleeping at night. My mind is held captive by the issues. And then David says, how long will my enemy be exalted over me? In other words, there are times in our lives in which we begin to wonder, God, did you really speak what you said? Was that really you, or did I misunderstand it? God, are you really up to something good? Are you going to bring something out of this, or is this my lot in my life? Is this what I'm left with? Oh, yeah. We've been there. David is promised to be the next king. He's anointed to be the next king, but he's living in a time in which the king is trying to kill him. He's trying to destroy him. So what do you do when you come to these moments in life in which it seems that it's not changing? What do you do when it seems as though that you go to church and you just can't connect? You just don't feel like you used to feel. You don't feel the joy. You don't feel the excitement. What do you do when you go through life and it seems that everybody else around you, it's all working out for them, but it's like every time that you get ready to walk through an open door, the door just slams shut? What do you do when you trust God and you step out, and then it seems as though that what God challenged you with stepping out is just like taken away from you, and now you're out here and you're not knowing what to do and where to go and how to work through? What do you do in these moments when you cry out to God at night and it just doesn't change? It's still there the next morning and the next morning. What do you do with those types of seasons and types of difficulties in life? Well, this is what David did. David said, I will sing. Amen. right in the midst of the trouble, I'm going to sing. I don't know how it's all going to work out, but I'm going to sing. I don't know how the pieces are going to come together, but I will sing. When you read the text, David's not saying, God, when you bring everything together and everything is great and I ascend to the throne and Saul is no longer around here to torment me, then I will sing. No, David is saying right now, smack dab, in the midst of my trouble, while living in a cave, while living on a run, while having a lot of questions in my mind, while laying myself down to sleep at night, not knowing how it's going to work out, I'm uncertain about what tomorrow is going to be like, but even right now, God, I'm going to sing. David had an answer. I will sing. Amen. I said this at 8 o'clock. I'm going to say it right here in the 10 o'clock. This is not a filet mignon. This is meat and potatoes. This is cornbread. This is fried potatoes. I mean, this is the basic stuff right here, okay? We read scriptures like this, and we hear preaching, and all this sounds really great, and we get all hyped up, and then we go right back to dealing with our same problems, and we don't take the Word of God and apply it to our life. I remember a time many years ago, there was a couple going through major issues in their marriage, and I was family pastor at the time back in Tennessee, and just like unbelievable issues in their marriage. And I, to be honest, Brother Creed, I didn't give them a whole lot of hope. They were coming to the married class, and I had been preaching and teaching on the need to get in the Word of God. And I was like, you got to get in the Word of God. You got the Word of God. Well, they came to see me, and he had had an affair, and the lady he had an affair with was pregnant, and they had only been married for about a year and a half. And I'm telling you, it was a mess of a situation. And I remember sitting across from them in my office, and I said, you got to get in the Word of God. You got to get in the Word of God. You got to get in the Word of God. And I kept saying these things for about 30 minutes, and finally the Lord spoke to me, and he says, he doesn't know how. And I said, now, I've been teaching on this for several weeks now in the married class about the Word of God. I said, do you know what I'm talking about? He just looks at me. I said, you what? I said, turn to the book of Philippians. And I gave him a chapter and a verse. And he started at the very beginning of his Bible and started flipping pages. And so I walked over to his Bible and I said, let me show you. And I turned way back, because Philippians is in the New Testament, not the Old Testament. And so I went way back in the Bible, and I found the verse, and I said, let's read this. And we began to read it. And I said, now, I want you to take those verses of Scripture, and I want you to apply it to your situation. He just looked at me like, I have no idea what you're talking about. And I said, well, let's take this word right here. I said, it's talking about the peace of God ruling in your mind and your heart. And I said, let's take that right there. And I said, let's figure out how to apply it to your situation. He still didn't know. So I began to talk to him. I said, you're about ready to lose your job, right? Because you had an affair with a coworker. He said, yes. I said, you don't know if your marriage is going to last, right? He goes, yeah. I said, you're getting ready to lose your little baby because you have a two-year-old. And I said, you're going to lose all this. I said, your life's a mess, right? And he goes, yeah. I said, you have a hard time sleeping at night, don't you? He goes, yes, I do. And I said, well, this Word of God right here lets us know that with prayer, with supplication and thanksgiving, let your request be made known unto the Lord. And then I begin to talk to him about that. I begin to talk about the rest of the verses that says, think on these things, whatsoever things are just and awesome. I begin to talk to him. I said, hey, I'll tell you what. I said, I want you to take this, and I want you to go home, and I want you to dive deeper into these verses of Scripture. And then I want you to come back next week, and we will meet for an hour, and we will talk it all through. And so a week later, he and his wife walked back into my office. He's on one end of the couch. She's on the other end of the couch. And I said, how are things going? And, man, it just exploded again. It was just a bunch of fighting. And just it was nothing constructive. It wasn't healthy. And I just stopped and I said, okay, wait just one second. I said, have you taken care of your homework? Have you read the Scripture? Have you gone through these things? And he said, no, I didn't have time this week. I got up and walked over to my door, and I said, but I don't have time to meet with you right now. And he was just like startled. And I said, look, I said, you have a major issue in your marriage. I can't fix your marriage. I said, only God can. I said, you're going to have to get into the Word of God and apply it. I said, I'll tell you what. I said, let's go ahead and just end this right now. You come back next week having done your homework. I said, because this is your marriage. It's not my marriage. This is your marriage. You're the one with the difficulty. You're the one who's going to have to apply the Scripture And I said, we're going to get done talking. I'm going to go home, and I'm going to eat, and I'm going to enjoy supper with my family. Everything's going to be great. And I said, but you're going to have to go home and deal with the problem. I said, so I want you to take time, deal with the problem. And I said, go through the scripture. He came walking back in the next week. He had a notebook pad. He was flipping pages of it. He had scriptures written down. He said, I didn't know it, Brother Wilson. He said, but this scripture here goes to this verse over here, and this verse connects to that verse, and this is what God has been saying. And it wasn't about another month or two that God filled him with the baptism of the Holy Ghost with the evidence of speaking other tongues. They're still married today. Amen. So you got to apply it. So let's be real here this morning for a second. Let's just speak. Let's slow this thing down and make sure that we get it. Because there are people in this place, and I'm one of those people, that if I'm not careful, I can lay myself down to sleep at night, and my brain will start trying to figure everything out, and I'll lay there wide awake for hours on end trying to figure it all out. And you've got to get to the point where you just say, I'm not going to do that. Instead, I'm going to sing. Now, let me be really practical. When I lay myself down at night, if I start singing, literally, oh, how I love Jesus, my wife is going to kick me out of the bed. What I mean by I will sing is that I am not going to allow my brain to sit here and become captive to the issue. Instead, I'm going to turn around and I'm going to magnify the King of Kings, the Lord of Lords, and I'm going to say, God, you got it. God, you're worthy. God, you're working it all out. I trust you. Therefore, I'm going to lay my head down and sleep. Here's another way of looking at it. I hear people that say, hey, how you doing? And they'll go like, man, I'm just hanging on. I'm just hanging on. You ever said that, Brother Waller? No? Good. I'm just hanging on. Just tying a knot in the end of the rope, and I'm hanging on. You ever said that? Pretty close? Sometimes? Okay, I got a word for you. Here it is. You ready? You want a word from the Lord? All right, here's the word. He hung on so you can hang loose. Like, oh, well, that's just really cute. That's real cute. No, no. Think about it. He hung on so you don't have to walk around life just saying, I'm just tied, knot in the rope, and I'm just barely hanging on. I'm just barely surviving. I'm just barely here. You don't have to do that. He hung on so you can hang loose. Somebody help him, Lord Jesus. I'm going to, Brother Warrior, I leaned over here a little earlier when Pastor was up talking. I said, thank you for helping me today. He said, I'm getting ready to go to children's church. I said, no. I said, we're going to have children's church in here in a little bit. He's been over there worried ever since. It's going to happen in a minute. David, this is what happens. His spirit begins to change when his talk begins to change. He says, the first thing, after asking how long, he says, but I have trusted in thy mercy. My heart shall rejoice in thy salvation. In other words, God, you're the one who saves me. You're the one who's been merciful to me. You've been good to me. I don't have to have it all figured out. I don't have to have it all worked out. It's okay because I trust you. Amen. When you trust him, you can sing. You don't have to wait till everything is all fixed to sing. You can sing right now if you trust him. David said, I have trusted in thy mercy. My heart shall rejoice in thy salvation. Hence, that's what he was saying. I will sing because God has been good to me. Amen. I want to help somebody out here a little bit today. I want you to turn with me to 2 Chronicles chapter 20. 2 Chronicles chapter 20. And I'm going to just skip down through some of these verses. Look at verse 1. Yeah, the Moabites, the Ammonites, Munites, they went to war against Jehoshaphat. Verse 2, some of the people are telling Jehoshaphat, there's this huge army that is coming to fight against you. And then in verse 3, Jehoshaphat is very alarmed by what is going on, and he decides to ask the Lord for some guidance. And then in verse 4, the people join in with him, and they begin to ask the Lord for help. And in verses 5 through 12, you will read the prayer that was prayed. And then, very interesting, in verse 14, the scripture says, then the Spirit of the Lord came on Jehazel, and he stands up and he begins to speak. And Jehazel says in verse 15, King Jehoshaphat, listen. And all of you in Judah and Jerusalem, I want you to listen, because this is what the Lord is saying to you. I do not want you to be afraid. I don't want you to lose hope because of this huge army that's coming against you, because the battle is not yours, but it is the Lord's. Amen. And then he says, tomorrow I want you to march down against them. Verse 17, you are not going to fight this battle. I want you to simply take your position, stand firm. You are going to see that the Lord is the one who is going to save you. I don't want you to be afraid. You do not need to lose hope. I want you to go out and face them tomorrow, because the Lord is going to be with you. Can someone say amen? Verse 20, Jehoshaphat stood up. He said, Judah, I want you to listen to me. Jerusalem, listen. He goes, I want you to have faith in the Lord your God. He's going to take care of you. Have faith in the word that his prophets have spoken. Then you're going to have great success. Verse 21, then he appointed men to sing to the Lord. They marched out in front of the army. They said, give thanks to the Lord. His faithful love continues forever. They begin to sing and praise him. Now, I don't want you to miss this. The word of the Lord was that the Lord is going to fight your battle. You're not going to have to fight. The Lord is going to fight. Brother Korea and Brother Oyer, I need both of you to come help me for a second. And I just heard one of them say, oh boy. And that was Pastor. Uh-oh. Pastor's worried. Okay. Now, you look like Karate Kid. Can you do some of Karate Kid moves? Karate Kid? Bruce Lee. Chuck Norris. Okay. Have either one of you ever taken any karate, kung fu, or Chuck Norris, knight, whatever it is? I don't know what you call the stuff. No. Barely? No. No? Well, you're getting ready to learn. Anybody in here, well, I shouldn't ask that. Where's Sister Majo? She's probably back in the nursery. Is she in here? Oh, come on up here, Sister Majo. We're going to have a little bit of fun. Come on up here. Yeah. We were having lunch here a few years ago, and I was eating lunch with Brother CJ and Brother James Key, and this is back when Brother James Key was twice the man it is right now, and he's my friend. And we were out eating, and we got to talking about if we needed some bodyguards. And I said, well, I want Brother CJ, and I want Brother James Key. And I said, I want Brother Marshall. And I said, oh, and a fourth one, I want Barbara Maggio. I said, because I think she's probably the toughest out of all of them. And so I want you to show them, like how to throw a punch. Just like what kind of, you know. Is it like this, or do you want to explain it? Do you want to talk about it?
You want me to explain how to punch somebody?
Talk about your expertise. Why do we have you up here right now? You are a...
No. Not a quadruple. You're going to make me talk about myself. Okay. I guess the reason why they have me up here is, put that phone away, Callie. Thank you. I'm a second degree black belt. I've been doing martial arts since about the second grade. So thank you.
So I want you to show them how to throw a punch.
I mean, if I was going to punch someone.
If you were going to punch someone. See, he, look at him. He looks evil. He looks evil, and he's coming to steal your purse.
Oh,
Now, don't throw him over your shoulder or anything like that. I know, you're exactly. But just like, just show him how you would throw a punch. What would you do?
In all honesty, I probably wouldn't punch a guy.
You wouldn't punch him?
No, because guys are like really structured and strong, so whatever I try to hit, I'm
going
to hit him in the eyes or in the
groin. Oh, you're going to hit him in the eyes. There we go. You hit him in the eyes. Okay, just do like you're going to hit him in the eyes, but just don't hit him in the eyes. Here you go. Safety glasses. Yeah. Just like that. Do you see that? Do that again. Do it one more time. Look, she turned like this to get some weight behind it. It wasn't like this. I have no idea how I get myself into these messes right now. This was not planned. This is not hers whatsoever. Brother Oyer keeps moving away. Come back over here, Brother Oyer. Okay. There's one thing, though, that you didn't do that I was thinking that you might would do, but it's not real. It's make-believe. Is that when you get ready to do something like that, do you ever or would you ever go, ah, like you're going to make some kind of sound, or would you just do it like just total quietness, like boom, just let the power do the speaking? Okay, you just breathe out because you don't have to do the other. Yeah, you don't have to yell. Okay, thank you. You ruined my illustration. Let's give Sister Barb. Actually, I figured that's what she would say because she knows what she's doing. Now, Brother Corinne, Brother Oyer, y'all come up here. No, you're not done. You are mad at each other, and one of you has just done something wrong, and you're getting ready to get in a fight with one another, and you're going to throw a punch. You're going to do something. Just pretend. Don't mess the illustration up, okay? And then you're going to do what? You're going to...
I'm just trying to feel out what you want. Sister Barb
is just like going to just hit and be done with it. Brother Oyer is going to yell like a little girl, like, ah. So this is what I would imagine, like, if I was, like, really, really upset and I'm going to fight like that, I'd be, like, making some kind of noise. I'd be, like, yelling or doing something. And so that's what I want to see. I want to see you guys, like do something, make some kind of noise. Just, I've already got you out here. You might as well just go ahead, sucker punch him, do something. But,
oh.
He just simply pushed him on the shoulder.
That's as far as I want to go.
Okay, both of you pretend that there is enemy right here and you are in an old-time ancient army and all you've got is the long
spear
and maybe a sword, yeah. And there's enemy and they're standing right there and they're coming to take your wives away and your children, they're going to destroy your home and you got to get all this in your mindset, that they're going to cost you your job. I heard about that football player. Said that's what he thinks. He said, it was all said and done. They're taking food off my table. And now, what are you going to do?
Ah!
There you go. That is perfect. Brother Korea, I haven't got him built up yet. Come on now. Yeah. All right. Get out of here. All right. Give him a hand. So in ancient days, this is exactly what they would do. We read about in American history, Yankee Doodle went to town riding on a pony. You know, American Revolutionary War. They would sing songs. You'd hear about the Civil War and the rebel cry. And so what would happen is that they would sing and they would yell and there would be some kind of like, loudness that would do two things. One, to strike fear in the hearts of the person they're getting ready to attack, and also to try to raise their level of courage. When the scripture says that the Lord has spoke to King Jehoshaphat and to the people that the battle is the Lord's, it's not yours, that lets us know that the army, and you'll notice, look at the text, the army didn't go out singing. The army didn't go out shouting because they weren't trying to win the war as though that we've got some kind of weapon and now we're going to go out and defeat the enemy. The fact is that the scripture says that they appointed singers to go out in front of the army. In other words, it was a testament that we are not going to have to fight. We're just going to sing. We're not raging war. We're just going to sing. Now, I know that we've got some songs that we sing, and one of them that I happen to like is that the weapons, talking about our weapons, that this is how I fight my battles. This is how I fight my battles. Now, we need to understand and make sure that we understand what we're singing about if we're going to sing it biblically correct. You don't have a weapon that you can go out and you defeat an enemy. It's not about you defeating the devil or you defeating the demon or you putting some things in place. It's not about that. That's what sometimes when we sing as though that what we're singing. In other words, I'm tired of all the stuff I've been going through. I'm tired of the struggle. Therefore, I'm going to get a song and I'm going to charge forward and I'm going to change everything with my singing. That is not what the Bible is saying. That's not what the scripture is saying. When Paul and Silas are in prison, they don't sing because they're trying to get out of jail. I'm going to sing, and therefore all this stuff that's on me and these chains, and it's all going to be gone, and I'm going to live free. No, that's not why you sing. You sing because he's worthy. You sing despite the circumstance. You sing even if God doesn't change it tomorrow. You still sing because he's still worthy. Come on, somebody. He's still worthy despite the trouble. He's still worthy. He's still God. He's still merciful. He's still good. He's good all the time. I don't understand it, but I sing. So what you do when you sing is that what you're actually doing is you're telling self, I'm going to get in alignment with what God has already spoken. I don't have to fight. I don't have to rage war. I don't have to do any of that. The weapons of my warfare are not carnal, but they're mighty to God, pulling down a stronghold. Through God. I don't go out there and do this thing. I don't have the ability. I don't have the strength. It's not about me being the one to sing. It's not about me being the one that's loud. That's what the false prophets of Baal did. The false prophets of Baal felt that somehow if I do enough, I'll get a hold of God. So they yelled, and then they yelled louder, because if I yell and if I get loud, then God will do something. That is wrong. Even Elijah, the prophet, he got caught up in thinking that, well, if I do all of this, we get fire, big stuff, grand stuff, great stuff, that somehow things will change. But when he did it, it didn't turn the nation. It didn't turn the queen or the king. It didn't turn anybody around. And he went off and he got himself in a cave, and now he's despondent. He's like, God, how in the world, what is going on? And then there was the earthquake, and there was the fire, and there was all this big stuff, all this loud stuff. But the Bible says God was not in it. And then a still, small voice. Let me tell you, when you get a hold of a still, small voice of God, you know that the Lord has said, I'm the one who fights your battle. I'm the one who's got it. You don't have to be loud. You can just simply sing. Everybody's looking at me going like, wait a minute, that messed up my theology. Yeah, we don't come down like the false prophets of Baal and put on a show for God to get God to go do something. God has already told you that you win. God has already declared in his word that the righteousness, they're not going to be forsaken. He's already declared in his word that all things work together for good to them that love the Lord and are called according to his purpose. He's already declared it in his word. Because he declared in his word, you can sing. In other words, you can make sure that your mind isn't got you so messed up that you can't sleep at night. You can make sure that your mind is not causing you to be so messed up that you can't eat a meal and keep it down. You can make sure that you got your mind so fixated on the word of God that you know that God is going to come through, that you're not worried, you're not filled with anxiety, you're not stressed out, because you know that God is on your side. Yeah, we have moments just like David did. God, how long? God, how long? God, how long? God, how long? But then you make sure you turn it around. But God, you're merciful. God, you're good. You're good all the time. Therefore, I'm going to sing. I wonder if somebody here this morning that could turn it around right now. Lift your hands and your voice and say, God, I'm going to worship you despite the problems. God, I'm going to magnify you despite the calamity. God, you're good despite everything that I'm going through. Hallelujah. He'll turn it around in due time. He'll take care of it. He'll take care of it. Praise God. I wouldn't do this. You may be seated just for a second. Music come. I wouldn't do this except for the fact that I asked her a couple weeks back, Savannah, come up here and help me real quick. I asked her about this a couple weeks ago. I heard the story, and I went to her mom, and I said, do you think that Savannah would mind? She goes, go ask her. And I went to Savannah. She goes, oh, tell everybody. She didn't say it like that. But it was a while back. Now, how many of you know, and I know y'all know this, but Savannah is a worshiper and a phenomenal songwriter, and she truly has a walk with the Lord. And this, I'm going to give you a story, just real quick. I'm going to give you a story that showcases that what she does up here isn't just what she does up here. This is how she lives. She gets a phone call. Next thing you know, her world, as she knew it at that point in time, was messed up. It was a sucker punch. It was one of those moments that it takes your breath away. And her mama comes to pick her up because she's at the point in time, can't really even drive. And she tells her mom, she says, I want you to pull over in that gas station right there. And they pulled over in the gas station. And she said, I sing about it. And I won't put it in my own words here, but you tell me if I'm correct, was what you said. I sing about it on the platform. I write songs about it. But now I'm going to live it. As she got out of the car, as she began to worship, as she danced and walked and cried and all of this around the car. She said, I know it's not going to change right now. She said, but my God is still good. My God is still faithful.
Did I tell it about right? You want to add anything to it?
Amen. That's what I'm talking about. It doesn't immediately take away the heartbreak. It doesn't immediately take away sorrow. It doesn't immediately just open up doors, make everything right. But she aligned herself with the Word of God. It wasn't a weapon to go out and defeat things and change things. We could say it like this, but it was a weapon to make sure that her mind was fixed on the one who's always merciful, always good. I'm here to help somebody here today. I'm here to help somebody here today. It is not God's will. Weeping may endure for the night. It does not say that weeping shall endure for the night. It doesn't say that it's always going to endure for the night. It says that it may endure for the night. But joy cometh in the morning. I'm here to tell you, even today, in the midst of all the stuff going on, you can still sing. You can still align yourself with a God who's good all the time. Would you stand with me, lift your hands to heaven, and lift your voice right now? Would you just magnify the Lord? Would you glorify him right now? Just lift up your voice. God, I glorify you. I exalt you. I worship you. You're so good. God, you are good all the time. You're good all the time. I praise you even today, God. I praise you. I praise you. I praise you. I lift you up, Lord. I praise you, Jesus. I praise you, Jesus. I praise you, Jesus. I just wanted to help somebody here today. I felt directed of the Lord a couple weeks ago. I haven't gotten this out of my spirit. I just felt so led to help somebody understand that you don't praise him. You don't worship him to get God to go do something. Now, what happens is that when we get ourselves in alignment with the Lord, it's amazing how God just works things out. I think many times what God is just waiting on is for us to get in alignment. Amen. So would you step out right now where you're at, walk down this altar and just lift your hands and voices and say, God, I will sing even right now. God, I'll sing even right now. God, I don't know how you're going to work it all out, but I'll sing even right now. I don't know when it's going to end, but I'm going to sing right now. I'm going to praise you even right now. God, I will worship you because you're good. Even today, God, I lift up my voice and I magnify you. Even with the uncertainty, even with the questions, God, I will sing. Hallelujah. I praise you, Lord. I praise you, Lord. God, you're so good.
You never failed me.
God, you're so good.
And you won't start now. So come and do what you do. God of infinite power, you've never failed me. And you won't start now. So come and do what you do. God of infinite power, you've never failed. Start now. Come into my God.
hope that you got the message of what Dr. Wilson was preaching about today. Our worship should never be projected at a problem, but it has to be offered up to the Lord. By projecting your worship towards your situation. We've heard a lot about the power of worship, but sometimes we can hear so much about the power of what worship does that we lose sight of the purpose of worship. And the purpose of worship invites God into our situation. Amen. Now, there's some benefits of that, in that the enemy is defeated and the devil is dealt with in our life. But, you know, maybe think of it this way, that the battle that you're fighting, he mentioned this briefly, the battle you're fighting is not that situation. It's not the enemy. The real greatest battle that you have in your life is right up here inside of your mind. Amen. Romans chapter 5, I believe verse 22, I believe, says that the mind is the enemy of God. It's not subject to the law of God, neither indeed can be. And so your mind is the enemy that's defeated in praise and worship. Now, it changes everything. Yes, it does. But we don't worship to change everything. We worship because God is good. If you remember in Exodus 2, when God called Moses from the burning bush, and he gave him a directive, I want you to go tell Pharaoh to let my people go that they might go and worship me. Now, we know the end of the story, and we know that it was all about their freedom and their liberty, but that's what worship does. What you start in worship eventually ends in liberty and freedom and victory. Pharaoh's mistake was not so much about letting the people of God go. His real mistake was that he got in between the people of God and the God that they worship. So he sort of separated God from the worship that he was receiving. And so it's so important that when we worship, amen, our minds are on the Lord and that we're giving God all the glory. How are you projecting your praise? I've seen people project their praise at stuff. It doesn't make any sense. I praise you, Lord. I'm going to get you, devil. You know, and they can't make up their mind if they're projecting it at the enemy or at God. It's not, that's not the purpose of praise. That's ineffective, strange fire. Our praise needs to come from a place of love for the Lord. Let God take care of it. Amen. Screaming at the enemy is not going to make a difference. Now, I believe in loud, lifting up a loud voice. Many places throughout Scripture, the Bible says we ought to praise Him with a loud voice because it engages our spirit. So it's important. But not every praise has to be a scream. There's not more power in a scream than there is in just a word to the Lord, except that it engages your heart and your mind. You use a great example, the prophets of Baal. And Elijah's soft, but 63-word prayer. They were screaming and they were making a lot of noise, but it was just a lot of noise. And at the end of the day, there was no fire that had fallen. They had made a lot of loud sounds and noise, but God hadn't answered. But it was in a soft, just simple 63-word prayer that God responds and sends down the fire. Amen. You know, sometimes we can get so weary through life and our jobs, and we come to church and we're exhausted, we're tired, and we think, oh man, I've got to run the aisles. No, what God is looking from us is sincere praise to Him. Amen. It's not all in this, but it's not in any of this. Surfing the internet during the service. Amen. We've got to give God the praise that He's worthy of. Amen. And let it be sincere. Let it come from a sincere place in your heart. Amen. Amen. Thank you, Dr. Wilson, for that word. If you felt like God touched you, maybe you're ready to get your life together. You're ready to make a change in your life. I want to encourage you to take a step of faith. Amen. To do something. This God that we serve is a blessing God. Philippians chapter 5 says that God shall supply all of our needs according to his riches and glory. God is able to do it. Amen. And so I encourage you to be faithful in taking that step of faith. Do something. Faith without works is dead. There's three things that I'd encourage you to do this morning. Immediately following service, I want you to stop by the little table out in the foyer. It's a great first step. You sign up for our what we call our membership experience. You can sign up for our small groups we have every month, or you can sign up for one of our Bible studies that we have. But each of those are great first steps. Maybe you've been attending for a while, but you're not really connected. You're not a member yet. You want to take that next step. These are three great things that you can do to take that next step in serving the Lord and drawing closer to him. Amen. Thank God for what he's doing in this place today. We serve a great God. Look at somebody beside you and tell them, our God is great. Amen. Our God is so great. So thankful for what the Lord is doing. Amen. Amen. Why don't we go to the Lord in prayer of dismissal. Let's pray that God would be with us. Remember our service tonight. Lord willing, I will be preaching the service tonight. I believe the choir is singing. It's going to be a great night of worship. Let's pray together. Father, I thank you, Lord, for your word. I thank you for the power of your word. I pray, God, that you will help us today, Lord Jesus, to fulfill your promises declared by your word. Help us to always maintain that song in our heart. Lord, at the lowest moments of our lives, God, remind us of this message that we could find a place of praise and worship. We know you are always faithful to us. We thank you for it in Jesus' name. Everybody said in Jesus' name, God bless you. You are dismissed in the fear of the Lord.
I build an altar for you.